getting bashed against toilets, bodies getting thrown around, seeing people getting carried out on stretchers. And it put a look of shock on my face when I first went in. The gang members would come up to me and say, you've got to get that look off your face, or you're going to get preyed on. I'm going to read you next one of the first incidences of violence that I saw. I'm in the day room, I'm on the phone to my girlfriend, and this is what happened. The commotion was in the shower area, about 15 feet behind me. Skinheads were attacking a naked figure on the floor. Inmates stopped what they were doing, gravitated toward the shower area, and formed a sinister audience. What is it? My girlfriend asked. Looks like some kind of disturbance, I said into the telephone. What? What's wrong? You all right? She said, her voice starting to crack. Sure, I'm fine. It doesn't involve me, I said, distracted by the violence and proximity of the growing crime. The naked man raised his head, and I saw it was another new prisoner called David. There was a plea for help in his eyes as they briefly met mine, a look that froze me against the wall. I might need to get off the phone here soon. Die, you sick chomo. Rob, the biggest of the skinheads, yelled, dropping his heel on David's temple. Chomo is American prison slang for child molester. Ah! What's going on? Are you okay? Claudia asked, her voice hitting some high notes. The skinheads vied for a stomping room. David arched his back in agony. Yes, I'm fine, I said, struggling not to relay my fear. It just gets crazy in these places, that's all. The blows silenced David. Blood streamed from his nose. I have to go now. I love you, I said, not wanting to worry her any further. Love you too. Every time I go to my mom's house, I take your sweaty t-shirt and Floppy. Floppy was a Bilderberg that played my voice saying, Happy Valentine's Day. I love you, Bungleby. One of the skinheads jumped up and down on David. I thought I heard his ribs snap. Bye, love. I hung up. The spectators had adopted the safety and numbers survival strategy of the wildebeest. None of them dared venture from the herd. Mesmerized by the violence, they watched from a safe distance. Gripped by the same instinct, I joined the back of the herd. As if they'd exhausted their supply of aggression on David, the skinhead stopped the beating and marched away in unison. David was a whimpering, heaving mound of flesh, blood pooling around his head. What kind of a world am I in? I thought, this stuff really happens. How will I survive? Just when the violence seemed to be over, a rhinoceros of a man with spider webs tattooed on his thick neck approached the skinheads. How come we can still hear the chomo? We smashed the chomo, good dog. Not good enough. The man went to the shower with the casual gait of someone going to the shop to buy a bottle of milk, grabbed David's neck, and started slamming David's skull against the concrete as if he were trying to break open a coconut. Crack, crack, crack. I was revolted but compelled to watch. The big man had increased the stakes. I didn't doubt the code of these people included killing anyone who interfered or flagged down a guard. Even walking away would be a show of disapproval, an invitation to be attacked next. I was terrified. David's body convulsed, his eyes closed, stillness, silence. He remained on the floor until the guard walked apart 10 minutes later. When the guard saw him, he announced lockdown. So we all ran back to our cells. And they're bringing the body out on a stretcher. I put my eyes right up to the window to want to see what the damage was. And the guy, not only was blood coming out of his head, it was like a yellow fluid, like brain stuff coming out as well. I'll never forget it.